And once again, what can I say but welcome back to Chapter 3, Part 4, Measurable Organizational Value, MOV, and the Business Case. So let's go ahead and jump to the slide that we ended on. As soon as I can find that little darling, there it is, and we'll get started. So we looked at the idea of a little business case of hiring an additional IT worker just to sort of bring us back. Notice in order to do that, I needed to bill 110.3 hours just to break even on this employee based on my calculations. And of course, there we talked about alternatives of hiring a part-time person or allowing existing employees to work overtime. Okay, so at a certain point, also, you know, as we talk about overtime, let's not forget burnout, right? And is an employee really willing to work overtime? Some employees need to work their 40 hours a week. They have family, they have other obligations. So that brings us to return on investment. And when we talk about return on investment, standard calculation, total expected benefits minus total expected costs, divided by total expected costs. And what that gives us here in our example is, in this case, a percentage. Okay. Now we can also do simply return on investment of looking at, you know, or finding that break-even period. The two kind of work together. Okay. But in this case, return on investment, our organization may have a limit, which means we've done enough projects to know in order to do a project that's going to be successful, we have to hit a certain percentage of ROI before we're going to take on an optional project. Okay. Now understand, again, we could do projects where there is no return on investment and there's a cost to the project, but we're required to do it to stay, again, within regulation. You've heard me say that enough. But then we have to build those costs or those expenses of that project, you know, against the revenue. And sometimes, by the way, it may be that, you know, that there's risk we're willing to take in not doing the project. I'm gonna go ahead and run this video because I find that this lady's video here, she will give her name, which I think is good enough. I will make sure to include in the notes a link to this video to give credit where credit is due. Let's go ahead and watch this as it regards to net present value and projects.
Hello, this is Sheba from financetrain.com. In this video, I will discuss how to calculate the net present value of a project. The net present value is the most commonly used measure used to decide whether to invest in a project or not. The net present value of a project is equal to the sum of the present value of all after-tax cash flows from the project minus the initial investment. So what we are essentially saying is that if the project will earn us so much money in each of the coming years, what will be the value of that money earned in today's terms? So we will get the present value of the future cash flows from the business. We know how much we have invested in the business. So NPV is the difference between these two. The investment decision using the NPV method will be based on whether the NPV is positive or negative. The NPV will be positive if the present value of all future earning is more than the money invested. A positive NPV indicates that the project is worth investing in. On the other hand, a negative NPV indicates that investing in the project will not be wise. The formula on screen is used to calculate the NPV of a project. The numerator represents the cash flow at time t. R represents the discount rate chosen to calculate the present value. This is also the desired rate from the project. T represents the number of periods for which we will receive the cash flows. Let's take a simple example to illustrate the calculation of NPV. Assume that your company is looking at investing $100 million in a capital project. The project will return post-tax cash flow of $30 million for 3 years and $50 million for the fourth year. Assume a discount rate of 10%. As you can see, the present value of all future cash flows is $108.76 million after considering a desired rate of 10%. This investment can be done for $100 million today. The wealth of the investor will increase by $8.76 million. Therefore, the investor should invest in this project. Thank you. Visit Finance Twitter.
So, let's talk real briefly about the discount rate, because that tends to confuse people. The discount rate, as it says here, will be the company specific as it's related to how the company gets its funds. So consequently, if we're borrowing, you know, what's the rate of borrowing? We have to take that into consideration. You know, what does that mean in the way of cash flows for other projects that we may do? How is that impacted, et cetera? So we leave that to the financial experts. Make sure you get that from the CFO. They're gonna have that rate. You're gonna wanna apply that to the project. Now, remember, just because a project has a positive NPV does not mean that we would take it on. We would want to figure out the project NPV for that project, for other alternatives, you know, find that rate of return. It may be that we invest more at the beginning, but produce better results over a longer period of time. Now, remember that IT projects and IT solutions are not necessarily projects that we would take on, if you will, just because the NPV warrants it, okay? So just kind of keep that in mind. Here's a net present value. Looks like I've got this slide kind of messed up here. Let me see if maybe I might be able to fix it. There we go. So, you know, time period, here's that example. So we have this outlay of cash, you know, here, discounted cash flow. Notice we're applying a 0.08 as our discount rate, okay? And we've got the influx of cash, net present value, which means in today's money, 77,000. So we might indeed invest in this project. But remember, if there's another project that we are looking at doing, whether it's similar project or a completely different project under the umbrella of projects that are supporting the organization, this project may in fact not be the one we take on. So scoring models, when we talk about doing this, we need to have a solid scoring model. So it provides a method for comparing alternatives or projects based on a weighted score. So a scoring model is something that we will apply equally to each and every project or alternative we're looking at. It can combine both qualitative and quantitative criteria. Weights and scores can be subjective, of course, but the biggest thing is we need to apply it equally as best we can to all alternatives. So let me give you an example of this outside of an IT project. If I was hiring a network administrator, what I would do is I would come up with a model for analyzing the resume. So basically, if they had a certain amount of experience, if they were longer term on jobs, meaning they didn't jump jobs. I was just talking with someone in human resource allocation, you know, a headhunter, as I like to call them. And they were saying today, people make it 18 months in IT before they're jumping jobs. That's sort of the average. But if I wanted somebody that was going to be there longer, they would get a higher point score within the metric. If they had the degrees I was looking for, higher point score. If they had certifications, there was a point score for that. And the reason I did this is because when I applied it equally amongst the candidates, I'd get a score without looking at the candidate's name, age, et cetera, which of course we're not supposed to look at, but let's be realistic, you know, and say some people do. But what this allowed me to do is really look at the facts and the data that then of course I asked them to prove in making my decision of who I was gonna interview. Okay, so it gave me a starting process in the way of weights and scores, you know, et cetera. So then things to keep in mind about the financial scoring. So financial models can be biased towards the short run, of course. Some criteria are reverse scored, so we have to keep that and past experience. So let me give you a quick example here. You can go ahead and pause this, and I would suggest you do. Look at project 1, 2, and 3 as it pertains to comparing these project alternatives, you know, and which one we would take on and why. Okay. Now, if you notice here, one of the interesting things is in these scores, this is an example, you're not going to normally find a project variance, you know, between 2.65 to 8.5. You go, oh yeah, we got to take on this one. These are going to be a lot closer if your metric is applied equally. So if you start seeing outliers, you really want to ask yourself why that is an outlier and find out. Finally, we're going to end up proposing and supporting the recommendation. Now, I want to be clear, anytime that I make a project proposal, I include the alternatives, okay? Usually at least 2 to 3 other alternatives, because what I think is the project, again, I just spend a lot of time and effort. I can end up being biased on this. I don't want to be biased. Okay, and it's not my decision to make. The executive management staff, the stakeholders of the project, everyone else who's going to be affected. I'm just the IT manager or the project manager. At the end of the day, project's done. I move on to the next project. I've got to make sure that it's matching what the needs of the organization are. And in doing this correctly, I may have a favorite project, but again, it's not me, it's the organization and what's best for them. So, you know, once the alternatives are identified and analyzed, the last step is to recommend one of the options. Again, I like to be realistic on that. As we create the business case, the written documentation to present, here's what we're going to end up with. And if you've ever written an APA style case analysis, in my master's, I had to do a case study analysis on Harvard business cases. This is how we wrote them. So, you know, title, subtitle, author, that all makes sense. And executive summary, what this is remember, executives aren't going to read through all of your documentation. They're going to read the executive summary. So we've got to keep this short and concise. We've got to include the facts and just the facts, not the supporting data, if you will. So the executive summary, say for a spreadsheet, is going to be the chart or graph that's created based on the data. The data still has to be there. It needs to be factual. But what the executive is going to look at to make the decision is the pretty chart that we have provided. So in this case, you know, brief description, problem, you can go ahead and pause and read this. Again, notice the alternatives are included in there, the analysis of the alternatives. We want to make sure to include for historical and knowledge management, what metrics we used, etc. So when we're auditing this project and seeing if it produced what we expected it to produce, we have this document to audit against and to look at the historical value 5 years from now if a similar project is being proposed. Finally, to finish this off, so the IT project selection process, the decision, of course, you know, project must align with the organization's values, vision, mission, strategies. Project must provide MOV that can be verified at the completion of the project. And again, my suggestion is not only at the completion, but let's set a time to re-audit to see if we're getting the value we needed, or to make sure that the project that we've done is in fact resulting in the revenues, resulting in the benefits a year from now that we expected. Because if the market changes, et cetera, we may need to make changes as well. Anyway, that's it for chapter 3. I hope you enjoyed these videos, and I look forward to, I guess it would be seeing you, having you see me for chapter 4. Take care.